Conference. Frankly, that would have been a sort of a more fun topic to talk about than what I'm going to talk about. But I want to make it clear at the beginning, particularly for any that are watching or going to be listening later on, that Richard has asked me to address an issue this evening that has emerged as a growing controversy, which some have quite forcefully been accepting and teaching and promoting, particularly on Facebook and the internet. If you would get two passages, get Romans chapter 8 to start with and Colossians chapter 2. Romans chapter 8 and Colossians chapter 2. So let's just start with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your word. We pray this evening that as we're going to sort of talk about a controversial subject and a subject that is somewhat emotionally charged, even right now as we speak with many believers, that we'll be able to do so in a way that will not stir things up further, but will hopefully bring light to an understanding from the Scriptures about these things. And we're grateful for the opportunity to do that and for the Word of God rightly divided that helps us to understand what's going on today during the dispensation of grace with the church, the body of Christ. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, look at verse 17. Paul writes to the Romans and he says, "And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together." The controversy that I've been asked to address this evening is the controversy related to the issue of being a joint heir. There are many out there right now, some that were part of this group, who are presently teaching that not all believers are joint heirs with Christ. And they're doing that, and it's created some controversy. And just some personal testimony to start with, I first became aware of this issue last summer at the July Summer Family Bible Conference. And when I got home from that meeting, somebody sent me an email that contained a paper that had been circulating on the internet and Facebook. And I read the paper and sort of put it aside for a while and wasn't really sure what to make of it. And then shortly after that, somebody anonymously added me to a Facebook group that was dedicated to discussing the issue of joint heirs. And I was sort of a wallflower for a while, just sort of paying attention to what was being said. And I'd started noticing some things that I thought were a little bit strange, I guess, for lack of a better term. And so I picked the paper up again and I read it through two more times. I engaged in some conversation there and realized that it was pretty futile conversation and sort of withdrew myself from that particular group and purposed at that time that I was going to construct a paper. And that's the paper that you have been given. So if you haven't received one, I hope there's enough for everybody. But the paper is 40 pages, and there's no way I'm going to cover in roughly an hour 40 pages worth of material. So what I've tried to do is figure out, okay, how am I going to summarize this and sort of boil it down to the crux of what it is that people need to know. And so we appreciate Brother Jordan at the expense of Grace School of the Bible producing the paper and distributing it to you. So the way I've constructed this is to discuss the following four points, okay? And the way I've conceived the study this evening is to discuss the problem, the source, the solution, and the implications, okay? The problem, the source, the solution, and the implications. And to get us started off with point one, the problem, folks, is that all believers are not complete in Christ. Go over to Colossians chapter 2, if you would. You all know the verse that is written up here across the facade of the assembly here at Shorewood Bible Church, Colossians 2:10, ye are complete in him. And the issue of the believer's completeness in the Lord Jesus Christ is I would perceive that to be a fundamental tenet to what we understand as mid-Acts Pauline dispensational grace believers who understand justification by grace through faith, who understand the issue that we're not saved by our works, we're saved through the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, that our religious performance and exercise and activities mean nothing in the eyes of the Lord, but that his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, gave himself for our sins upon the cross, shed his blood, and rose again the third day. And when we believe that message, we're made complete in Christ. We receive God the Holy Spirit. We're indwelt by God the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes in. He takes you out of Adam. He puts you into the Lord Jesus Christ, baptizes you into the body of Christ, seals you into the body of Christ, gives you a position in Christ. And one of the things that you get as a result is a standing of total completeness in the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, folks, there are some that are questioning that. And you need to be aware of that. There are some that are questioning this idea that this doctrine, this verse, Colossians 2:10, and ye are complete in him. There are two ways that the idea of our completeness in Christ is being questioned. The first one comes from a position known as sonship edification. Sonship edification says that only those who attain unto a Colossians level of edification are complete in Christ. So what they're saying by implication is that all believers are not complete in Christ, and that there are level 1, level 2, level 3 saints, and that you have to progress through the Pauline epistles to a Colossians level of understanding, and it is only once you've attained unto that level of edification in your inner man that you are in fact complete in Christ. A second view that is out there currently is what I've termed for these notes the corporate view. Look at Colossians 2:10. And ye are complete in him. What the corporate view is basically saying is that it is only the agency of the body of Christ that is complete in Christ. That the individual members that comprise the church, the body of Christ, are not complete in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that it is only the agency of the church, the body of Christ, that is complete. And they're getting that from the use of the word ye in verse 10. And ye are complete in him. So they're saying the logic of the reasoning goes like this. Well, it's ye, he's referring to the body corporate, and only the corporate body of Christ, all the believers collectively that comprise the body are complete, and that the individual members in the body are not complete. And they'll go to Colossians chapter 4, to try to tie the rag on the bush with respect to this. And they'll look at Epaphras here in verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. So what the reasoning is this. See, if the Colossians were all complete in Christ, then Epaphras would not have to pray that they would be complete in Christ. Whoops. That they would be. So if they were already automatically complete in the Lord Jesus Christ, Epaphras would not have to pray for the Colossians that they would be complete. Now, look. First of all, it's not my job this evening to teach this issue. John Verstegen is going to come behind me and elaborate on these things in much more detail tomorrow night. I just want to make you aware of them here this evening. But look at verse 12, if you would. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may what? Now, wait a minute. I thought that this what this view is saying in verse 10, in chapter 2, verse 10, is that the ye is corporate, and that it's only the corporate member, the corporate church that's complete. But then you come over to chapter 4, verse 12, and what word do you see in the verse? Ye. Folks, this is the kind what I'm just going to say, poor Bible study that is going on right now that is being passed off as wisdom. Come with me to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, look with me at verse 3. Verse that all of you know. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed who? Us. See? Us. It is the body corporate that is blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. It is not the individual believers. It is a corporate thing. It is a thing according to this view that only applies to the collective body as a whole, not to the individuals which comprise the body, is what these brethren are maintaining. Now, look, folks, go to verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the who? To the saints which are at Ephesus. Who are the saints that are at Ephesus? All the believers that are at Ephesus, right? How's that verse end? And to the faithful in who? See, Paul is addressing in Ephesians the believers as well as those believers that are what? Faithful. So when he says in verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, who is he referring to? He's referring to all the saints that are at Ephesus, the faithful and the what? The unfaithful. So this idea that you have to attain unto the spiritual blessings, let me make sure I get this right. Supporters of this view say, as I said, that the us in verse 3 is a reference to the corporate body, not the individual members, And while all the members of the body of Christ have access to these spiritual blessings, they are not possessed by all believers unless they perform the work of faith or the walk of faith, i.e., they are not properly sanctified. Folks, verse 1 tells you who he's addressing. He's addressing believers, all the believers, and the what? The faithful. And he brings them together in verse 3 and he says, he's blessed who? Us. With all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Folks, the foundations of our faith as mid-Acts Pauline grace believers are under attack from those within our own movement by way of a misunderstanding and a misapplication of what it means to be a joint heir with Christ in Romans 8:17. These brethren maintain that there is a difference. Come back to Romans 3. Come back to Romans 8. Go back to Romans 8 with me. These brethren maintain that there is a difference between being an heir of God in Romans 8:17 and a joint heir with Christ. Look at Romans 8:17 if you would. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. So what they're saying is that in verse 17, there's a difference between the believer that is an heir of God and the believer that is a joint heir with Christ. And they're making those two separate, distinct, different inheritances there. And from there, they are promoting the idea that joint heirship is conditional. Look at the verse again. Verse 17, and if children then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him. So it's believed that the if so be is placing a condition upon the previous part of the verse, and that only those that suffer with Christ in the appropriate manner as they've defined it are the ones that are going to be joint heirs with Christ. And it is the logic now of these two separate inheritances that is being read back into other passages to come up with things that question, like, whether or not we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, and to argue that the body corporate is complete in Christ, not the individual members of the body. Folks, I'm just going to say it this way. The grace life is being replaced with a works-based system of sanctification that appeals to the believer's flesh and establishes different classes of believers with different inheritances. I personally have a problem with that. And I believe that you should too. Okay? I'm not trying to tell you what to do or have dominion over your faith, but if we understand the mid-Acts Pauline grace message, it has all of us complete, all of us blessed, the very moment that we trust the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to move on and talk. I've sort of already spilled over into it, but I want to talk about the source. The two inheritance view of Romans 8:17 purports, as I've said, that not all believers are joint heirs with Christ and that there's a difference between an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ in Romans 8:17. Now, the sonship edification position on this says the following. Quoting now, joint heirship with Christ is reserved only for the sons of God who have realized the value of their adoption as sons, understand and appreciate the worth of the Father's business and the curriculum he has written to properly edify and educate you, and then wholeheartedly commit to it. So if, number one, you have to know this curriculum. Number two, you have to wholeheartedly commit to it. And if you don't know it or don't commit to it, you're not a joint heir. Okay? Now, this is what is passing off as magnified, wonderful Pauline edification. This works-based sanctification. The suffering for the mystery view, again, quoting, this is a little bit longer quote, but it's important that you hear this. The suffering for the mystery view states the following. Everyone in the body of Christ is an heir of God. This is to say that all in the church, the body of Christ, are recipient heirs of eternal life in heaven. However, not everyone in the church, the body of Christ, will be declared a joint heir with Christ. The reason being that joint heirship is very much conditional, as the words, if so be, would attest. What does it mean to suffer with Christ? How can we define the suffering which is spoken of here? There's a tendency that exists among some in the church today to view Christian suffering in vague and general terms. The common view is that anyone who believes in Christ is also by default suffering for Christ. While there is a very real suffering that comes from professing faith in Christ, this is not the type of suffering that is being referred to in Romans 8:17. Now, here's the point. At this point, I submit for your consideration that suffering with Christ referred to here speaks of a special kind of suffering that is inherent to the Pauline doctrine itself. This is to say that this suffering is unique and exclusively appointed to saints who stand steadfastly in the rightly divided paradigm of Scripture. Folks, that means that any justified, saved, Acts 2 member of the body of Christ is not a joint heir if they don't understand and attain unto Pauline doctrine and truth. Okay? Irregardless of the level or the nature of the suffering. Either version of this view, folks, hinges in Romans 8:17 on a conditional reading of the if so be part of the verse. So what I want to do now is move on into the solution. That's where I want to spend the most of the time. The solution, folks, is that all believers are joint heirs with Christ. Look at verse 16. Romans 8:16. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of who? Are you a child of God if you've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ? Does he talk in verse 15 about having received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father? So if you are a member of the church, the body of Christ, verse 16, the end of verse 16, emphatically declares that you are a child of who? Of God. Verse 17, and if children. Now wait a minute. When he says if there, does he mean to call into question whether or not you're a child of God at the end of verse 16? No. He is saying, he's using the word if there in the logical function of the word if. Right? You understand that if can be used as a condition, right? Like if this, then this. Or the word if can be used in the statement of logical fact. If this is true, then this what? Follows from it. Or if this is true, then this is true type scenario. Does the end of verse 16 state as a fact that you're a child of God? Verse 17, and if children. So when you get to verse 17, is he all of a sudden questioning whether or not you're a child of God? No, he's making an argument. He is building a logical argument. And the logical argument that he's building in verse 17, is that if you are a child, and by the way, he's only talking at this point in Romans to those who are. Okay? If you are in the state of being a child of God, verse 17, then heirs. Heirs of who? So if you're an heir, your inheritance, your heirship, if you will, is going to come from who? From God. Okay, verse 17, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God. What's the next word? And. So you're an heir of God and joint what? So if you're in the state of being an heir of God, are you also in the state of being a joint heir with Christ? Read English. Okay? Read English. The English tells you that if you're a child of God, by logical extension, you are an heir of God. And if you are an heir of God, then you are also a joint heir with who? With Christ. Now, I want to build for you. This is, you have to understand, this seemingly fundamental basic point is being questioned, okay? The definition of a joint heir. If I look up the word joint heir in the dictionary, this is what it says. Excuse me. An heir having a joint interest with another. That's the definition of a joint heir, okay? All believers are heirs of God. Romans 8:17. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of who? Are you an heir of God? Come over to Galatians chapter 4. Go over to Galatians chapter 4. Hold your hand in Romans 8. You don't want to lose that. Go over to Galatians 4. Galatians chapter 4. Look with me at verse 7. Galatians chapter 4, verse 7. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God, how? Now let me ask you a question. How are you an heir of God? Through who? So in order for you to be an heir of God, you have to pass through the work of Christ to be an heir of God. So how can you pass through the work of Christ to be an heir of God and not also be a joint heir with Christ? That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard in my life. Okay? Come back to Romans chapter 8 again. Look at verse 32. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered it up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us how many things? All things. Okay? Come with me over to Hebrews. Come over to Hebrews chapter 1. Folks, what's the definition of a joint heir? A joint heir is an heir having a joint interest with what? Another. Are you an heir of God, according to Romans 8, 17 and Galatians chapter 4, verse 7? Are you an heir of God that inherits all things? Yes. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, verse 2, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his what? Son. Who's his son? His son is the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, whom he hath appointed heir of all things. Let me ask you a question. Is Jesus Christ an heir of God? Are you an heir of God? Does that meet the definition of a joint heir? A joint heir is an heir having a joint interest with another. You're an heir of God. Christ is an heir of God. Therefore, you're both what? Folks, this isn't hard. Okay? You have to be looking for something here to not see what is plainly there. Now, getting a little bit ahead of myself. Come back with me if you... let me just finish that. Therefore, all believers must be joint heirs with Christ, because both are heirs of God who inherit all things. Are you an heir of God that inherits all things? Is Jesus Christ an heir of God that inherits all things? For you to become an heir of God, did you have to go through Jesus Christ to get your heirship, your position, your inheritance? And in doing that, you pass through the Lord Jesus Christ, who is also an heir of God, and you've been joined to who? Christ. Folks, if you look at that, don't do it now, but if you look at that paper, the last appendix in that paper, one of the things that I did in researching for this is I looked at earlier translations of the Textus Receptus into English, and do you know that there would not have even been an argument about joint heirship until the Bishop's Bible came out in the 1560s? Because every translation, Tyndale, all the way through the Geneva Bible, you know how they rendered that in English? They said, heirs annexed with Christ. You know what it means to annex? To annex means to join hard to something. Okay? Hitler annexed Austria. Okay? The dude over there, Putin, he's annexed part of the Ukraine. Right? And by the way, heirs annexed is past tense, meaning you've already been what? Joined. Folks, think about that. Heirs annexed. I'm not suggesting that we should change the King James Bible. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is what that demonstrates is that this joining has already what? Taken place. It has already occurred. Now, come with me back if you would to Romans chapter 8. I have notes, but I've already sort of departed them. Folks, I've been criticized for being passionate about this topic. I will continue to be passionate about this topic because this is a stepping stone into overthrowing the faith of many people. Romans chapter 8, verse 17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, the next issue that's going to come up is the punctuation. How is that verse punctuated after heirs, joint heirs with Christ? Semicolon. Okay? So here we go. Grammarbook.com gives five primary functions or rules for the use of semicolons. I only gave the two that would be relevant in this particular case. Rule 4, Use the semicolon to separate units of a series when one or more of the units contains commas. Look at verse 8. Sorry, not verse 8. Look at verse 16. The sentence starts in verse 16. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit, comma, that we are the children of God, colon, and if children, then heirs, semicolon, heirs of God, comma, and joint heirs with Christ, semicolon. Is that an appropriate function of the semicolon? Okay. Well, turns out that the 1611 King James Version and the 1769 King James Version aren't punctuated the same. So what that's being used to say then is that, well, you can't make an argument here based upon the punctuation because they're not punctuated the same. Folks, listen, I am not a grammar expert, okay? But to me, this is ridiculous, all right? Do the both of them have a punctuation mark after joint heirs with Christ? One's a colon, one's a semicolon. And to say then that that proves that being a joint heir with Christ is conditional because that one has a semicolon and this one doesn't, is now what you're saying is you're forcing somebody to have to pick which one of these is the one they're going to use. And if they're going to say, well, that one's wrong, then from now on they better only use that 1611 King James Bible, or now they're not being consistent. Folks, I have been criticized for playing Greek grammar tricks and concordance games in that paper. Okay? By people that will use the 1769 text and completely disregard the fact that there's a semicolon in the text. You can't have it both ways. You can't have it both ways. That's either your text or it's what? Or it's not. Now listen, if so be, go back, look at verse 17. So it says, and if children, then heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be, that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. So following the semicolon is the if so be. So what's said is that if so be is placing a condition upon being a joint heir with Christ in the previous clause, okay? And it's the word if. Now, let's go back to the beginning of the verse. And if children, was that if an if of condition or an if of logic? Okay, so then he says, and if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. What they're doing is they're reading that if so be as a statement of condition, not as a statement of fact. Okay? Now, why do they not do that with the first one, but then all of a sudden do it with the second one, other than it fits what they're trying to convey? Now, let's talk about the if so be. Whoops. The if so be section, oh, I thought I had a note on this. It's probably out of order. No, it's not out of order. I apologize. There it is. If so be serves the same function as the first if in the verse. It's a statement of condition. A statement of logic or fact, not condition. The underlying Greek word epir occurs 6 times in the Textus Receptus, and according to Strong's Concordance, the Greek word epir carries the following meaning: if indeed, since, and if after all. Look at Romans chapter 8, verse 9. It says in verse 9, "And if, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you." Folks, if that is a statement of condition, you don't have the indwelling Holy Spirit. Okay? If it's a statement of fact in the sense of since or indeed or after all or what have you, if so be, then it's maintaining the integrity of the statement. If you make it a condition, now what you're saying is you don't have the indwelling Holy Spirit. Look at the next one. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Come over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul begins a logical argument here with the Corinthians regarding resurrection. Go back to verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12. "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead. How say some among you that there is no resurrection from the dead? Okay. Was Paul preaching that Christ rose from the dead? Yes. So he writes to the Corinthians and he says, look, if Christ didn't rise from the dead, how is it that some of you are saying that he what? That he didn't. Okay? So he's asking a question there in verse 12. And then he's going to set out after that to make an argument. Verse 15. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? So, in other words, if there's no such thing as resurrection, is it possible that Christ rose from the dead? No. Verse 14, and if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up. Here it is, if so be that the dead what? Now look, is he questioning, when he says if so be that the dead rise not, does he mean to question the reality of resurrection? No, he's clearly building a logical argument regarding resurrection. How do you know that? Read on, verse 16. And if the dead rise not, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. What does verse 20 say? But now Christ is risen from what? Folks, when he says if so be in verse 15, does he mean to question whether or not Christ rose from the dead? He's clearly using that to make a what? To make a case, to build a logical argument regarding the issue of resurrection that started back in verse 12 when he says to them, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection from the dead? He's addressing a doctrinal error or question at least that had crept into the saints at Corinth. They're beginning to question whether or not the resurrection is there. And you know and I know that fundamental to Paul's gospel is the fact that Christ what? Rose from the dead. Now, if indeed, since, after all. So, considering the definition of the English words, indeed and since will help establish the intended meaning behind the Greek word. Indeed is usually empathetical, but in some cases, more so than in others, watch this, as this is true, it is indeed, or for the purposes of obtaining confirmation of a fact stated, indeed, it is possible, the word since, because that, this being that fact. Now, what are you talking about, Bryan? Come with me, if you would, to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. The same Greek word that is translated, if so be, in the two verses we just looked at, three verses, Romans chapter 8, verse 9, Romans chapter 8, verse 17, and 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 15, it shows up here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Look at verse 5. He says, which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that ye may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which ye also suffer. What's the first word of verse 6? Seeing, it is a righteous thing then with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you. Folks, when he says seeing there, is he talking about seeing a ball game? Seeing a movie? What does he mean? It's being used in the sense of since. It's part of the statement. It's the same Greek word translated seeing there by the King James translators that translated if so be in the other places. And guess what happens if I go to an English dictionary and look up the word seeing? The participle appears to be used indefinitely or without direct reference to a person or persons. Wherefore come ye to me, seeing ye hate me. Genesis 26, that is since, or the fact being that, or thus because that. When you go back to Romans 8:17 and you see the if so be, do that. Go back to Romans 8:17 and you see the word if so be there. That word is not a word of condition. That word is a word of logic. That word is a word of continuing the argument or continuing the thought, if you were, that is being presented. Paul is not in the middle Let's say you take this as a statement of condition. And if children then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer. Who's the we in verse 17? Well, look at verse 16. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that who? We are the children of God. So I have a question. If that's putting a condition upon it, when exactly did he start talking to a different group of people? When exactly did he switch in there from talking about the heirs of God to the joint heirs with Christ? What he's saying there is true for all believers, for all who are the children of God in verse 16. They are the heirs of God in verse 17, and they are joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him. So trying, now think, the whole thing is backwards. They're trying to make, if so be that we suffer with him, a condition on being a joint heir. But what the verse is actually saying is, you can't suffer with him until you are joined to Christ. You have to be joined to Christ and be a joint heir with Christ before you can suffer with Christ. Because if you're not a joined to Christ, and if you're not a child of God, and if you're not an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ, yeah, you'll go out and you'll suffer, but you can't do it with him. So, suffering with him. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. In addition to arguing that the if so be is conditional, the two inheritance mindset seeks to connect Romans chapter 8, verse 17 with 2 Timothy 2:12. I'll talk to you about that here in a second, to argue that suffering with Christ is unique individual suffering for the truth of the mystery by individual believers. Let me read you a quote. The author writes, I submit for your consideration that suffering with Christ referred to here, that's Romans 8, 17, speaks of a special kind of suffering that is inherent to the Pauline doctrine itself. That is to say that this suffering is unique and exclusively appointed to saints who stand steadfast in the rightly divided paradigm of Scripture. As 2 Timothy 2:12 suggests, there will be those in the body of Christ who deny Christ, and likewise will also be denied by Christ. Of course, the context here speaks of not losing one's salvation, as verse 13 attests, but rather of one's inheritance being denied. Paul is warning us here that the inheritance and honor of reigning in eternity as joint heirs with Christ will not be granted to everyone in the church, the body of Christ. Before we leave Romans 8, look at it again. If so be that we suffer, how? With him. Come over to 2 Timothy chapter 2. You should probably hold that. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Now, as I've studied the one issue, I've started to see some things about this other passage in 2 Timothy 2 that I'm not really going to have time to get into. In fact, I've already about 25 pages into another paper, but on 2 Timothy, the faithful saying of 2 Timothy chapter 2. But look at verse 12. Just look at verse 12. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. Does it say anything about suffering with him? Does it say that? Does it say anything about reigning with him as a joint heir? No. It says, if we suffer, we shall what? So if you read the verse as follows, if we suffer with him, subconsciously inserting Romans 8:17 into this verse when you read it, because you have to make it work for your system, if we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him as joint heirs. Is that what the verse says? No. Now, why would 2 Timothy 2:12 say, if we suffer, and Romans chapter 8, verse 17 say, if so be that we suffer with him. Why would one say with him and the other one say suffer? I'll tell you why. Because the underlying Greek words in Romans 8:17 and in 2 Timothy 2:12 are not the same word. So the concept in Romans 8:17 is the concept of suffer with. Look at it again, Romans 8:17. If so be that we suffer with him. The suffering that you're going to undergo there is a suffering that is with him. This other word, this in 2 Timothy 2:12, he says, if we suffer. It doesn't say suffer how? With him. Why not? Because the words aren't the same. Folks, if you're going to say that Romans 8:17, if we suffer with him, is the same thing as this here, what you're doing is you're saying that God, the Holy Spirit, and inspiration doesn't know the difference between Greek words. That's what you're saying. Suffer with. Look at Romans 8:17. There's only one other time that that word occurs. There's only one other time that the Greek word translated suffer with him occurs here, or occurs in the text of the New Testament. Come with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians 12. Come over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul here is talking about the body of Christ. He's using the illustration of the human body, talking about the various members and so on. And you come down to verse 26. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer how? With it. What does that mean? That means that if Sister Charlotte is suffering as a member of the body of Christ, all the members in particular of the body suffer with the member that's what? Suffering. So the idea of suffer with is to suffer in common with another. So to suffer with Christ in Romans 8:17 is not the same as 2 Timothy 2:12. How do you know that? Go back to 2 Timothy 2:12. 2 Timothy 2:12, verse 12. If we suffer, go up to verse 10. Paul says, therefore I what? You know that the word translated endure in verse 10 is the same word translated suffer in verse 12. That's a different kind of suffering than suffering with him in Romans 8:17. The suffering in Romans 8:17 is suffering with him. Go back to Romans 8:17. It is a common suffering that all members of the church, the body of Christ, suffer together. The one over here in 2 Timothy, folks, that's not talking about the same thing, and the way you know that is the word's not the same. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we do what? Look at, if we are suffering with him, then that means we are suffering in common with who? With Christ. And the suffering that we have in common with each other and with our head of the church, the body of Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, it is something that we all experience. I have a question. Is the Lord Jesus Christ the head of the body of Christ? Yes. Is he the head of the church? Yes. As the head of the church, the body of Christ, is he a member of the body of Christ? Yes. He's the head, right? And everyone else are the other parts, the other members of the body. Where one member suffer, Sister Charlotte, all the members suffer how? With it, that would include who? Christ. Are you identified in Romans chapter 6 with the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you spiritually through identification, are you there with Christ on the cross? Are you there with him in his burial and his resurrection and the newness of life and all that? The answer is yes, 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 and what? And yes. Okay? As a justified member of the church, the body of Christ, Galatians 2:20, that the life also of Jesus Christ might be made manifest where? in my mortal flesh? Does Christ seek to live His life out through you and I? And so when we, as members of the body of Christ, suffer anything, look, how else can Christ suffer? Ephesians 1, is He exalted far above all principality, power, might, dominion, and every name that is named? Can somebody take Him out of there and put Him back on the cross? Can somebody throw stones at Him or poke Him with sticks or, you know, stick wet willies in His ears or something? No. His suffering in that regard is over and done. It's finished. But He identifies Himself. He lives in me. He lives in you. And when a member of the body suffers, all the members suffer how? With it. So again, this is backwards. Suffering with Him is not a condition upon being a joint heir with Him. You can't suffer with Him until you have been made a joint heir with Him. It is exactly opposite to say that. Furthermore, look at verse 17 again. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified together. Folks, if that if so be is conditional, that means that there is a condition placed at the end of the verse on you and I being glorified with the Lord Jesus Christ. Uh-oh. Understand, read it again, verse 17. If so be that we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified together. If so be is conditional there and not logical, then what it's doing is it's saying you being glorified together with the Lord Jesus Christ is a conditional thing. How do you know that's not true? Read the next verse. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that might be revealed in us if we attain to proper sanctification. That shall be what? Revealed in us. Folks, there is nothing conditional in these verses in terms of maybe it is, maybe it isn't. Any conditional thinking here is if and it's true. Verse 17, and if children then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may also be glorified together. Now look at, he brings up the issue of suffering there in verse 17. What is that we suffer with Him? I already said, who's the we in verse 17? The we in verse 17 is all those who are children of God at the end of verse 16, right? Verse 18, for I reckon that the suffering of this present what? Folks, does that passage tell you what suffering he's talking about? He's talking about the suffering of this present what? You cannot prove what the two inherent position is saying by the text of Romans 8. The text of Romans 8, dealt with honestly, succinctly, and correctly, will not allow you to say that there's a difference. You can say whatever you want, okay? But if you want to believe and say that there's a difference between an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ, you're not understanding the verses the way they're written. You're not understanding the way they're written in English or Greek. Doesn't matter. Okay? Verse 18, for I reckon that the suffering of this present time... Folks, the word suffering there, the word suffering of this present time, that is in a tense, which means that the Romans are already undergoing the suffering while Paul is still writing the epistle. They haven't even gotten it yet, and he's already saying, you guys are what? But then he goes a step further. Read the verse 18. And I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in who? Us. Who's included in the us? Paul. Who's included in the we? So Paul views himself as suffering with the Romans presently when he's never even seen their face in the flesh when he writes the book of Romans. Wow. So if that's true, then they are collectively already suffering together with Christ, and Paul doesn't even know them yet. And he says in verse 18, "For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall absolutely, positively, definitely will be revealed in who? In us." Do you see what happens if you read "if so be" as conditional in verse 17? If you read "if so be" as conditional in verse 17, you're placing a condition upon you and I and Paul, who certainly attained unto, if anyone attained unto proper sanctification, it was Paul. If anyone was a level 3 saint or a level 2 saint or a complete in Christ saint according to those definitions, it certainly would have been Paul. And Paul includes himself with the Romans, who he's never met, and he says that they're children of God. He says they're heirs of God. He says they're joint heirs with Christ. And he says we're all going to be glorified together with the Lord Jesus Christ. Bottom line, end of story, wash your hands, go home. No, not really. This is a cut and dry case. Okay? And really? Got that? Folks, look. Hold, come with me back if you would. Hold your hand here. I'm sorry if this seems a bit random, but go with me to 2 Timothy 2. I'm normally much more organized. It's not that I'm not organized, but I'm just sort of excited, I guess. Romans 8:17, joint heir. An heir having a joint interest with another. 2 Timothy 2, verse 12. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. Does it say anything about reigning with him as a joint heir? Okay, so that's a definition of a joint heir, right? How do you know that a joint heir, that reigning with him is not being a joint heir? I tell you how you know. They're different words, and they don't mean the same thing. A reign. A joint heir is an heir having a joint inheritance to another. A reign is to possess or exercise sovereign power or authority, to rule, to exercise government as a king or an emperor, so on and so forth. Folks, this is dealing with your inheritance as a believer. You are a joint heir with Christ. That is talking about something different. It's not the same thing. It's not the same thing in English. It's not the same thing in Greek. It's not the same thing in any language. And to take Romans 8 and 2 Timothy 2 and conflate them together to say that only those who have proper sanctification, proper edification, or suffer for the right stuff according to our definition makes you a joint heir or an heir of God so that you can reign with Christ is beyond my ability to comprehend. I'm sorry. But it is. And maybe I'm speaking too forcefully and candidly for some of you. I don't know. But this, you'll see why I think by the end of this, why I'm so sort of jazzed up about this. Folks, the real problem here is there's a confusion of the issue of inheritance and reward. The real problem is a confusion between inheritance and reward. Your inheritance, by definition, is what you get by virtue of being a member of the family. Are you a child of God? If you're a child of God, are you an heir of God? If you're an heir of God, are you an heir of God through Christ, Galatians 4? And if you're an heir of God through Christ, you are also by definition a joint heir with who? Christ. Because Christ is an heir of God that inherits all things. You are an heir of God that inherits all things. You are a joint heir with Christ. There's a difference. That's talking about your inheritance. There's a difference between your inheritance as a member of the body of Christ and the reward you will receive at the judgment seat of Christ. And to confuse these passages is fundamentally to confuse the issue of inheritance and reward. Now, come back with me if you would to Colossians, where we started. This controversy, folks, has developed. Let me say it this way. If this were just an in-house disagreement about the nature of the inheritance, I probably wouldn't be so passionate about it. But the problem is it's becoming far more than an in-house disagreement about the nature of the inheritance, Romans 8:17. Because this understanding about the heir of God, being different from the joint heir with Christ, is now being taken and read back into other passages. Okay? A misapplication of the two inheritance logic regarding joint heirship in Romans 8:17 is now being read into other Pauline passages such as Colossians 2:10. Now, the logic progresses as follows. Okay? So, 2IV, that's two inheritance view. I got sick of typing that out, so I just abbreviated it. Okay? 2IV. So, 2IV logical progression. Number one, not all believers are joint heirs with Christ. Now, this is the most important part of this study. Okay? Number two, being a joint heir with Christ is conditioned upon proper sanctification and suffering with Christ in/for the rightly divided paradigm of Scripture. Number three, only joint heirs reign with Christ. Okay? Since being a joint heir is conditional and only joint heirs reign with Christ, all believers will not reign with Christ. Believers who don't attain unto joint heirship due to incomplete sanctification and or a lack of proper suffering will not reign with Christ. This is the argument they're making. Believers who don't reign... Now, here it is. Believers who don't reign with Christ as joint heirs are lacking something, and they are therefore not complete in Christ. Now you've taken it and made it a whole different thing. Up to this point, I could say, okay, we disagree. When you take the logic here and you say, aha, if all believers don't reign with Christ as joint heirs, they're therefore lacking something, therefore they're not complete in Christ. Now you've taken it and made it something totally different. Because now you've questioned one of the foundations of our faith as grace believers. Complete in Christ. But they go further. Completeness in Christ is corporate. The first point I made. Applying only to the agency of the body of Christ. Individual believers are not complete in Christ. Only those who attain joint heirship through proper sanctification and suffering are complete. Folks, do you see how this logic is progressing here? Only the agency, then, of the body of Christ is blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Not the individual. Individual members of the body of Christ are not blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. They have access to them, but do not presently possess them. They need to attain unto them through proper sanctification and suffering. In addition, all believers do... Now, listen to this. Go back to Romans chapter 8. Go back to Romans chapter 8, folks. In addition, all believers do not possess the indwelling Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit indwells the corporate agency of the body of Christ, but not the individual believer. Now, lest there be any doubt that I am making this up, I'm going to read to you three quotes about that point. Quote number one, Romans 8:9. Look at Romans 8:9. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, you already know that they took the if so be in verse 17 and made it what? If they make the if so be in verse 9 conditional, do you have the indwelling Holy Spirit? No, not necessarily. And apparently only those that do are the super sanctified ones. So the comment on Romans 8 quoting is this. The Spirit indwelling you is corporate. Paul is not saying that everybody will do this or every individual will operate. Not every individual has it dwelling in them individually. Next quote. Go to 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16. And we'll be done by 9 o'clock because I want pizza, okay? Verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God? What are they saying about the ye? Corporate, okay? Now, Brother John is going to take all this stuff. What I'm trying to do is set the table for what he's going to do with you tomorrow night. The comment made about this verse is quoted the following. The temple of God is the body of Christ, the agency. It's a corporate issue. The Spirit of God dwells or abides. That's a corporate thing. He's not talking about the individuals. Come to Ephesians 5:8. Come over to Ephesians 5:18. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. Ephesians 5:18, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with what? The Spirit. Quote, he wouldn't say that if it wasn't a choice. It's like going around and telling people to be human. They just are. If you're filled with the Spirit already, he wouldn't have to tell you to be filled. Conclusion. If you take this out, this all starts with a misunderstanding of Romans 8:17 and a dividing of two separate inheritances. And then having to say, well, if you're not attaining to this joint heir inheritance, you're not complete. So as soon as you say that, then you've got to go backward through the Pauline scriptures and make this distinction between what's corporate and what's individual. And before you know it, not all believers have the indwelling Holy Spirit. And if that's true, we don't have eternal security. We don't have eternal security if that's true. This is a dangerous thing that's being sold out there right now. If all believers do not possess the indwelling Holy Spirit, then how are they eternally secure? And I'll just finish with this point. The foundation, the very foundations of our faith are under attack by those within our own movement who are using their misunderstanding of heirship in Romans 8 to restructure the grace life into a system of works-based sanctification. Where this is leading to is to take the grace life truths that we have all come to rejoice in and to take them and wipe them off the board as though they never existed and to put you back under, I'm going to say it, under a sneaky grace type works program that's couched in grace terminology, but really has you working, striving, and back under the performance system to attain joint heirship and reigning with Christ. The entire line of argument that I just shared with you was developed as a consequence in the application of the false premise that there's a difference between an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ in Romans 8:17. This part of it here. Now look, I've been talking for an hour and 10 minutes. You have 40 pages to read everything that I wrote about it. This part right here, tomorrow night, Brother John is going to come along and he's going to take you to Colossians 2. He's going to take you to Ephesians 1 and probably Romans 8. And he's going to demonstrate the seriousness of this issue of making all of these things corporate and placing conditions upon them. But you need to understand tonight that the way you get to that point is through this chain of logic that I just took you through that started in Romans 8:17 by questioning the inheritance. So I'll end this way. Go to Romans 8, verse 14. Sorry, verse 17. I don't know why I said verse 14. Verse 16. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit. I just got to say this. Just one supporter of this actually told me, I said, you cannot sustain this view. You cannot sustain this view from the text of Romans 8 alone. Do you want to know what the answer was? The answer was based on verse 16, the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit, that the sign gifts functioning in the Roman church would have caused them to understand this the way he's teaching it. If that's true, I don't even want to get into the implications of that. Because if that's true, then you can't even know you're a child of God, because the work of the Spirit in verse 16 would have ceased, failed, and passed away when the sign gifts passed away. So how does anybody know they're a child of God if that's what you're going to argue? It is completely ridiculous. Anyway, I almost got going again, so we'll end. The entire line of argument, folks, has developed to support the false premise that there's a difference between an heir of God and a joint heir with Christ. And what I'm concerned about this evening is that you understand the logical train, how it gets you to this point. And now tomorrow evening, Brother John is going to come behind me and he's going to elaborate on these points further. I appreciate your attention and your patience with me this evening. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your word. I'm grateful for these saints that have gathered here this evening and been patient as we've gone through the scriptures to talk about an important issue, and I hope that it's not misperceived that my passion on this is somehow misguided or what have you. I'm just grateful for all the saints that are here, for all your complete work on our behalf, that we are complete in Christ, that we are blessed with all spiritual blessings, that we are indwelt by God the Holy Spirit, sealed into the church, the body of Christ, until the day of redemption, that we are all heirs of God, and that we are all joint heirs with Christ. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.